we can look at genetics and we can look at functional imaging, the endophenotype, and there's four main types of borderline patients. So to me, this is the new material. Patient walks through your door that, you know, all borderline patients don't look the same. Hey, do all depressive patients look the same? I mean, there's catatonia, there's atypical, there's melancholic, there's anxious distress. There's multiple types of depression, so why aren't there multiple types of borderline personality? And I want to drive that point home. There's this one, interpersonal instability phenotype. Their DSM symptoms tend to cluster about conflicted relationships, over-involvement, enmeshment, isolation, withdrawal. They do that splitting, idealization, devaluation more. And again, we can see that in their genes sometimes and their functional imaging sometimes. There's a cognitive self-disturbance type, right? You know, who am I? What's my identity? They also have self-contempt, chronic emptiness, self-hatred. These are the folks I lose sleep over. These are the ones that do not only the gestures, but the really severe suicide attempts. This is the group I worry about. But it's a different, again, set of genes and neuroimaging. Affective emotional dysregulation, the emotional ability, interpersonal reactions. They misread cues, right, and then overreact to them, social cues. And any of the behavioral dysregulation phenotype, right? These are the risky behaviors, the impulsive behaviors that get our patients into trouble. They don't really think through things that they're doing and then get in trouble again and again with other people. So I think there's really, again, looking at Gunderson's work, I like Gunderson's work. You'll see a bunch of the slides up there from that group. There's really four types of borderline personality. And you're actually going to see that the medications we talk about may work differentially depending which type of patient's in front of you.